Hi, everyone. So on this episode, I talk about a time when I used to be a magician and how that is connected to my journey now as a regenerative and organic farmer. And I look forward to sharing that with you. So I'll see you in the episode. So the big question is this: how do we live in more sustainable and regenerative ways? How can we tap into the ancient secrets of living in harmony with the sacred nature of life? How do we embody the interconnected web of life that thrives in abundance within each of us? That is the question, and this podcast will explore the answers. My name is Craig Hubbard, and welcome to Shambhala Living. Hi, everyone, and welcome back to the Shambhala Living podcast. On this episode, I'm going to share a story that I haven't shared with you guys yet, and I don't often share it anymore because I don't practice it. And that is, many years ago, I used to be a magician, a professional magician, and it seems quite worlds apart from where I am right now as a organic farmer, a regenerative farmer. But actually, it's not too far apart, and in fact, it's a very much an underpinning of the way that I farm and the way that I live based on this whole Shambhala Living way. And I think that it's important to share this because it's a way of looking at the world through the lens of life is magical. Firstly, just let's go back to the story of actually being a magician, and then we'll move to what's that got to do with growing food and how does that help you grow food. Way back when I was a little kid, I used to love magic. I don't know exactly where it came from, but I think it was just that inherent belief in magic, you know, seeing presents under the tree as a kid and believing that somehow they magically came there by maybe that was part of it, or the Easter Bunny, I don't know, like, but all the fantasy stories, the fairy tales, all of that stuff I hands down believed in, and I loved it. And I think that we all probably come into the world with our eyes wide open, our belief is wide, and then something starts to happen and we kind of lose that magic, lose that spark. And for me, maybe it was, you know, finding out, you know, and for if you've got kids in the car, then maybe I won't say some of the things that I want to say in case those that don't need to hear. But there were some things that I found out that kind of made me lose that spark. You know, my mum and dad telling me some things that I thought were true, and then kind of some things came crashing down. And that was probably the beginning of the end of a part of my magic life. But there was something that kept it alive, and that was my grandfather. My grandpop, each year he would, at Christmas time, he would, after lunch, he'd pull out this thing, and it would always be different every year, and it had something to do with magic, and I really loved it, and it sparked something in me and kept that dream alive for many years. And each time we would go to the Royal Easter Show, which was if you're in Sydney, and in Brisbane they've got the Ekka. So I used to go to the Royal Easter Show, and each year they would have the show bags, and I would always go for the magic bag. So that also sparks my thing. And then seeing some of the show magicians that are out there, they really lit something up. That was something that I started to do and play with. But then as my teenage years came about, I lost that. And I didn't believe in magic. I kind of understood from my teachings from school and from seeing the adults of the world, it looked like the adults had it sorted. They were telling me what to do. They were teaching me the ways of the world, supposedly through school, and it looked like the house was in order. It looked like, you know, you get a good job, you go to school, get a good job, get a mortgage and pay that mortgage off, retire, die, and that was the way. And it looked like that there was no spark left. And then something happened. I went to a friend's 21st. I was younger, I was 18, but I went to this friend's 21st and I saw this magician, and his name was Ace McDermott. And I saw him, and magic became alive again. He did things that just blew my mind, and they were totally unexplainable. And something lit back up inside me, this realization that had gone out or had been dimmed, this realization of, oh my God, like magic could be real. And it lit this thing back up. And at the same time, I was training in martial arts and doing my gradings to get my black belt. So I had this kind of double thing going on. I had this like magic life, and that was after meeting this Ace McDermott, this magician. I rang him and I asked, where can I learn? And he pointed me in the direction of a place, and I went down to this magic shop, this professional magic shop that was tucked in this backyard garage of this other magician. And I went down there and he gave me a job, and I'd go there after school and I would work in this shop and I'd meet magicians, and then I started to get job bookings and going out and doing magic. And the thing that I loved about it most was that although most of the thing that I was doing was an illusion, I still believed in a deeper sense of magic. And what I've come to see is that the world is so much more magical than what these illusions that I was sharing with people under the name of magic, the world is so much more profound than that. And that's actually why I ended up retiring or giving it up after 10 years of doing it as a professional magician, because I found things that were so much more profound. And that's where we kind of lead into this world of gardening and food growing and nature and connection. So at the same time, I'm also doing my martial arts, learning some absolutely mind-blowing things with meditation and mind control and auric sight and astral traveling and healing and all sorts of amazing things, and that were more so magic than even what I was doing as the entertainment. But from the entertainment side, it was really fascinating and wonderful to be able to go into a group of people that had it all sorted out in their minds, that they had life sorted, and to be able to do some simple things with some everyday objects and to see the look on their face of almost like the ground beneath them shaking and the fabric of their existence not being the way that they thought it was. And although that at sometimes I felt a bit of a fraud, it was like, because people really thought that was just mind-blowing magic, and on the flip side it was an illusion, I really enjoyed that it was using entertainment and illusion to show you that even through just the simple illusion that our eyes and our perceptions are so limited, that there is so much going on around us that we can only label, we can label as this concept of magic because it's unknown, but we, our brain can't handle that. So it puts it into these categories of, because it wants to know it. That's how we survive. We feel secure when we know that the ground is there and that the sun's going to come up and, you know, we've got our good job or we've got regular business coming or we've got food on the table. We've got this regularity and security of the way the world is, because if we woke up and the floor wasn't where we thought it was, that would really mess up our day. And so I love for the first 10 years of my adulthood was about using this entertainment, but also knowing through the martial arts, the kung fu world, was that there was some really powerful, real things that I certainly wasn't calling magic. They were like, it was like magic was too trifle of a word to use for them. So they were profound, but I also was told and very strongly encouraged, or not encouraged, I was told to not share these things as the martial arts, but as the entertainment, it was certainly encouraged to share this. And so it was kind of like using art and entertainment to remind people that the world was not all that it seems. However, then there were the illusions, but they still cut through and did the job to remind people that the world is actually magic. And people I'd see them afterwards, after I'd done some magic to them, maybe weeks after, and they'd still be like, "Oh my God, like, you know, nothing is the same anymore. What have you done? You've broken me, and you know, I can't think in the way that I used to think." And but it was also in this concept of, wow, like there's so much more than what is just that our brain can handle. And where that led to was this realization that we don't have to live the life that we're programmed to do, that our habitual ways are set to do. But the biggest one is that I think the most important thing that we can bring to life without having to bring a whole heap of knowledge and trying to accumulate all this knowledge, I think the most important thing that we can bring is the willingness to see life as magical. And there's another word for magical, because I think magic is just a word that we put in there when we don't know how things work. Like if we went back 100 years ago or 200 years ago and we brought out a computer, then people wouldn't understand how that works and they would call that magic. And a light bulb, if we turned a light bulb on, then that was considered magic back then for those that didn't know the mechanics of it. So when we know and understand the mechanics, or even when we don't understand the mechanics, but we understand that there is a way, then we don't deem it magic. But when the other way of seeing this is the world as sacred, the world as a living organism, the world as this profoundly complex super organism, interconnected being, or you could use all sorts of words in place of being and super organism, God, life, love, light. But there is something there that when I meet people that have that, whether that's in the martial arts world, that that understand energy flow and that there's the energy comes from somewhere and that we get to use that energy. It runs through our body and we get to manifest with it. And all other people that have a sense of faith and a sense of love and connection to this world that is sacred, something about them changes the way that everything changes, the whole underlying and the foundation of how they live and how they show up in the world, how they present themselves, how they offer themselves to others in service, in love, in art. And something happened to me after firstly using the art, using these the entertainment, using the illusion to switch the lights on to people, wake them up, give them a jolt into this concept of, hey, just if in case you thought that you knew how it all was, then it's more bizarre than you can possibly imagine. Like wherever you are right now, you might be driving, you might be walking the dog, walking with the kids, might be cooking. Wherever you are, you're standing or sitting on the earth, and it all seems fine and calm perhaps, but right now we are spinning faster than a bullet, flying while spinning and flying through space, through this solar system. And this whole solar system that is spinning around a sun that is beaming light, this whole solar system is spinning around a galaxy. Like, that is just mind-bending, mind-blowing, that the only way I can categorize it in my head is to give it some kind of name, like it's phenomenal, it's magical, it's sacred, it's... Whether I believe the science of it all or even understand the science of it all, that's not the point. I think the point is to, at any moment, to take ourselves out of the feeling that we need to know it all, whether it's growing the food, knowing all the technical jargon or not. The biggest thing that we can bring is this concept of the world is a magical place, and then the world is so much more complex than the simple ways that we have it in our head, because in our head can get complicated in a different sense. It can get complicated in a mental figments of our imagination, and we are connected to each other as a species, as a just one species. So in our head we can connect into that, we feel that, but thinking is so limited. Even Einstein said the most important aspect was imagination. Imagine this concept of imagination is more important than knowledge. And we think that in pursuit of this knowledge, for whatever it is for, like whatever the knowledge that you're looking to accumulate is the most important, but the connection to the perspective of living with a world that is, that we don't know it all. Like, I think that as uncomfortable as it can be to not have all the answers, I think that it's humbling first for the brain to say, oh, wow, like, I don't get it. I don't understand it. And it's like, that's a wonderful place to come from, when that brain starts to, like in the Matrix, you start to see the glitches. And I think that when we start to see the glitches, then the fabric of our mental world starts to break down. And that can be devastating and traumatic. But I think that if we can trust in our heart, which is a much deeper, more profound way of connecting, proven that the heart has more bioenergy going to the brain than the brain has coming to the heart. It's also got a much larger field of biophotonics, so light. If we look at ourselves under a light machine, then we see that our heart is generating and receiving far more messages, connections of this energy than our brain does. So our brain is like the workhorse of the heart. So when we start to see those glitches in the fabric of our reality, that's not our reality falling apart. It's just our perception of the reality starting to expand. So when we expand that out, then it has to break before it can rebuild itself at a larger level. And the way I believe we do that is by letting go of this need to control the way it is, to try and accumulate all of the knowledge so we can have it all. By letting it go, connecting into our heart, trusting in that this world is bizarre, made amazing, I choose to see it as amazing, not when I look at just the humans, because when I look at the human species, we are a dominating species. And when we only look at that, meaning like looking at the news, mostly that news is the human-centric world. And that is only one small fraction of the whole perspective of nature. So when we start to take in the wider perspective of nature and realize that we are part of this wider perspective of nature, then it does two things. I think that it firstly is a little unsettling. It's like, oh my gosh, like we aren't the dominating species really. We're the dominating species in terms of how far we've, you know, taken over the earth, but we actually, in the larger scheme of things, we are not the dominating species. We are part of an amazing interconnected universe, and particularly on this planet Earth, we are part of a self-regulating, self-healing, living organism, super organism. We are part of that, and there is evidence all around us, and all we have to do is let go of a little bit of our need to control and to find it in our thinking. Let that go and go into a feeling space of when we, going back to the magic days, when we see that illusion or that flicker in the fabric of what we thought was so real, that starts to see, wait a minute, what actually is real? Then we start to observe, I believe, at a greater level when we observe from the heart space, from the inner sight, from the inside out, is a way, I guess, of seeing that. So bringing that all around to, what does this have to do, Craig, with food growing? Well, firstly, Shambhala living, as we've talked about before, isn't just about food growing, but food growing is a major part, one of the main pillars of Shambhala, of living in connection with this amazing planet Earth. And it was one of the main things that blew my mind, that made all the things traveling the world, doing magic, paled in comparison to what I saw simply happening in my backyard garden, planting a seed that I put it in the ground, in the dirt, and just a few weeks later, there's food growing out of there. Or just a few months later, there's a plant with a pumpkin growing off it, or a tomato, or a zucchini, or the most beautiful, amazing flower, all from this little seed and this dirt and the elements of water, air, sunlight. That, to me, is amazingly magical. I have no idea, and no one really can give you, you know, we can give you like a scientific, well, this is what happens, but really, like, that's only one part of it, and it's nowhere near as important as the opening of the heart, the bowing down, the letting go of the control, and to be a witness to this magical place. And imagine that you could be living in a magical world, I keep using the word magical just because I do like that word, but you could substitute it for whatever, a beautiful world, a loving world. Like, imagine that. Now, I'm not saying that is right now happening, especially if we look out at the news or just seeing the fear and anxiety in people. It would be easy to say, well, that's not the world, but that is precisely where this magic framework comes from, to say whatever you thought it was, I guarantee if we were face to face, we could hold an ordinary thing, a spoon, a card, a piece of rope, and we could look at that and we could say fair and squarely, that's what it is, that's how long it is, that's how big it is. And I could do something that will change your perception to say that thing that you think that it is, the piece of rope that you think that it's this long, is actually two pieces of rope or three pieces of rope, or it's actually a whole lot longer, in an illusion. But just in that simple illusion can show you that the mind, it just makes things up to make your way of living feel more comfortable. That if you really knew the thing that you're holding, the phone that maybe you're listening to this on, that every single atom is made up of fluctuating energy, waves of energy, that there is no actual physical reality, that it is all just energy vibrating at different speeds and at different frequencies that give the different atoms the different capacities to create perception of the different realities that we experience. So this is all based on quantum physics, on quantum mechanics. And to me, that is a world, and when I started to delve down that track, that was a mind-blowing world of, okay, I think that this world is far more amazing, phenomenal, than what we give it credit for in our everyday lives. So when someone asks me the technical jargon of how do you grow a plant, or how do I get how do I get this to work in my garden, I think that it's not about always knowing those answers. Although we will find those answers, we'll share those answers with you. But the biggest thing that I'd like to get across to anyone that I'm working with is, first and foremost, is the perspective shift to start to see the world in a different way. Be an observer, be a experimenter with the understanding that you get to use your imagination, and therefore you can imagine the world as a beautiful, amazing, co-creative, regenerative world, or you could view it as the common view of what the world, what the human perception is right now, which is a jumbled mess of fear and anxiety and destruction and greed and hatred. So again, to not dwell on those messages, but to open up to the world of gardening. The reason I love it so much is because it's literally the natural world, the world that has been living far beyond, longer than humans have been here. We get to interact with it. We get to put our hands in the soil. We get to see and witness things that are growing. Like, I don't grow a tomato. I don't have any inkling of how to grow a pumpkin or a tomato, but I do know how to make the soil, the conditions right in the soil, so that when I put that seed in that soil and water it and put it in a position with it where the sun has access to it, then I can witness the magic of nature growing that seed into a beautiful tomato, flower, pumpkin, whatever. And that, to me, is a place that where gardening becomes a spiritual practice, a way of connecting, a portal, if you like, to this magical world that we can call nature. And the very definition, or one of the best definitions I've seen for nature, is that it is a system of interconnected systems and ecosystems, but a huge interconnected ecosystems all working in harmony with each other. Just like, imagine that you gave a whole bunch of instruments to 100 school kids and you just said, all right, play, just play your drums, play the piano, play the guitar, sing, hit the cymbals, play them. Imagine the sound and the chaos that would come out of that. But imagine that then that those instruments could start to come into harmony with each other. Then we have this concept of symphony, and symphony being those instruments, those vibrations starting now to pulse in harmony with each other, not necessarily all on the same frequency, but in a frequency that is relatively in harmony with the other frequencies. That's a visualization of just a small fraction of what nature is doing, interconnecting in harmony. So there is a way, there is a world that we can live in where we are too part of that system, where everything is in harmony, just like the most exquisite symphony or the simplest, beautifulest bird song. We can live in a world, and I believe we already do live in that world, but we do have to change the perception. And when we change our perception, everything changes. if that's all I can give you over everything that I've seen as a magician, as a black belt in kung fu, and as a meditation yoga teacher, and now as an organic farmer, regenerative farmer, the most important ingredient that I think we can bring to the table is one of awe and one of seeing the world as sacred, special, beautiful, magical. Anyway, that's my story of being a magician and how we can bring that world, that magic world, into the ordinary world that we see and we live in day to day. So hopefully you can go out into your world and start to see the glitches / the breaking down of the ordinary world, and behind that ordinary world, right in front of you, is a most magical, phenomenal world. So I'd love to see some of the, I'd love to hear, I mean, from you, what are some of the things that bring you out? Like, what's something that snaps you out of the ordinary world, the anxiety world, and brings you into the symphony world, into the harmony world, into the magical world? And last night I shared the thing that was doing that for me and still does that for me at the moment is seeing the flowers. They just, something happens when I'm seeing these freshly, these full blooming flowers. They're just, something just snaps me out of whatever thought I'm in and just takes me to this place of remembering that it's all going to be okay, and we're part of something super amazing, and we don't need to know all of the answers. We just need to start with that perspective shift and then plant those seeds of change, preferably actually literally into the earth. And if you're not yet gardening and you're plant those seeds metaphorically and figuratively out into the world, into the way that you live, the way you talk, the way you act, bring that sense of love, beauty and imagination or magic into your world. And one day I'd love to share some of the illusion, the fun entertainment side with you in some form. So anyway, that's all I have today. So thanks so much. It was a bit longer and I'll see you in the next episode. Bye for now and lots of love. Hey everyone, thank you so much for listening to this episode of the Shambhala Living Podcast. If you enjoyed it, then I'd love it if you would share it with some friends and subscribe to this channel and turn on notifications so you can find out when the next podcast comes out. You can find us at Instagram at Shambhala Farm, and also check out our upcoming 12-week food growing course. You can find out more details on our newsletter list or on Instagram. I'll see you on the next episode.